Hi, Curtis. Thank you for joining us for Hoya Gateway's virtual Power Lunch interview. We're excited to ask questions from Georgetown students today to learn about your career. A little bit about Curtis before we get started. Curtis Romig currently serves as the Atlanta office's litigation leader for Brian Cave, Leighton Paisner, LLP. He has assisted construction, financial, energy, technology, retail, healthcare, manufacturing, and transportation companies in resolving commercial disputes through negotiation, mediation, arbitration, and state and federal litigation. In his years of practice, Curtis helped one of his clients secure the largest verdict in the history of Brooks County, Georgia, in a design and construction defect case, and helped another client successfully resolve litigation involving issues related to improper preparation of sites for vertical construction due to the use of improper fill and materials. He has also successfully defended a major construction equipment manufacturer in a products liability action and a design build contractor in a workers' compensation and Longshore and Harbor Workers' Compensation Act case in New Orleans. Curtis graduated from Georgetown University with his AB in history and received his JD from the University of Virginia. Currently, he serves as a chair of Hoya Gateway's Executive Committee dedicated to forging impactful career connections for alumni and students. And now we'll dive right into questions. Thanks so much for being here, Curtis.
Thank you, Jihei. I appreciate the introduction. Probably needs a little bit of an update. That's one tip I'll try to remember to talk about today.
Our first question for you is, what are the top three most important things for students to prepare for when applying to law school?
The first thing I would say is that similar to coming to Georgetown, most of the law schools that the folks will be considering from Georgetown are going to be very competitive, and you should expect all of your peers and fellow students to be incredibly intelligent and just go in with the mindset that you're going to do the best that you can and know that everybody there is going to be on par with you. Secondly, I would say be prepared for an environment or know the environment you're going into. Some law schools are very competitive, and the students are not necessarily as supportive of each other as one would like. I would recommend that you try to attend a place where the students are supportive of each other and where there is a collegial environment that encourages everyone's success and doesn't encourage the success of one student over another student. And third, I would just know what type of education, what type of legal analysis your law school engages in. Some of the schools I attended, the University of Virginia School of Law, and at the time I attended, it was a leader in the thought of analysis of law and economics, and they very much favored the analytical approach based on that. University of Chicago is a similar institution. Other institutions have different formulas or different sort of concepts of how they want to present legal education. Those are just, there's so many things to do when preparing for law school. One very successful lawyer who was a CFO of a major transportation company and a friend of my father's told me that I should be prepared to study 100 hours per week at UVA Law. And I dismissed that out of hand as being virtually impossible. I probably would have done better, but I just didn't think that I was going to do that. So I think you have to know, and I will add a fourth. I will say, study the way you studied successfully in undergraduate. So many times you get to law school and everybody's buying administrative law in a nutshell, contracts in a nutshell. There's all these sort of books you can buy that short the courses. You need to prepare your outlines this way. You need to do this. I think the biggest key to success in law school is being true to how you learn. You need to study the way that got you there. There may be some minor tweaks and some changes you have to make because of the nature of the material and the way the test will be given, but remember how you learn and use that strength of yours to continue having success.
Thank you for that thoughtful answer, full of advice that I think students can take away. Our next question for you, Curtis, is what are the most important factors to consider when choosing which law schools to apply to and which law school to attend?
There are probably two most important factors, and they interplay with each other. One is cost. You have to look at the investment you're making and what you want to do with that investment and make sure that the return on your investment will be worthwhile. And the second factor of that is location. Where do you want to practice law or pursue your career if it's not practicing law? Where do you want that to occur? So you're looking at the cost of the education and you're looking at where you want to end up. And I think those two factors go together. If you know you want to be in a specific city, in a Chicago, in a New York, in a DC, don't be afraid to look at the state schools that feed into that city, because those can be very good schools. And you can, if you're an in-state resident, save a significant amount of money. And you need to look at what you want to go into. Do you want to go into private practice? Well, then you might be able to take on more debt, because debt is a part of most people's legal education experience. If you're going to go into public interest, or you're going to go into the government, as many Georgetown students do in their post-Georgetown careers, then you might want to look at taking on less debt. Because while there are some forgiveness programs at some of the more prominent and prestigious legal law schools in the country, that debt can still be crippling to you and make your pursuit of a career in public interest or the government much more challenging, because you'll be paying off that debt for 10 to 15 years, potentially. So you need to look at all that financial, that locational, and then what you want to do. I think I would add a third thing. What type of law do you want to do? And to the folks in the market that you want to go to, where do most of them go? And I'll add one more thing. Where will you be able to best network? As a Georgetown student, you have access to an international network of classmates, people in the class below you and above you, that you can mine for potential business contacts and for potential clients. But it may also be that you have contacts from your high school days, from growing up, and you might want to look, if you're going into private practice, to return to those roots so you can take advantage of that. The most important thing about a successful private practice is generally going to be, do you have clients that are your own and that allow you to have the most flexibility in your career?
That is a great comprehensive answer. Thank you for sharing so much. I think definitely important things that students can consider and will now start to think about as they're thinking about law school. Our third question for you is, how can an undergraduate student gain relevant experiences to legal education before heading to law school? Or do you suggest waiting until law school to gain exposure to certain experiences?
I think that there are some things you can prepare for and some things that are can be unique to your law school experience. I think one of the things you can prepare for is speaking in public. There are plenty of opportunities at a school such as Georgetown for you to engage in activities, be they academic or extracurricular, where you're on your feet, as we would say in the legal industry. If you want to be in the courtroom, the ability to be on your feet, think on your feet, and react to changing circumstances in the argument, in the cross-examination, in the direct examination, that ability to think on the fly is critical to success. There is a component of you have that talent. Obviously, some of the greatest trial lawyers of all time have that inherent ability, but there are many learned aspects to it, and practice makes perfect in that regard. So I think when you're on your feet and when you're well-prepared, that kind of experience, regardless of whether it's law or just some kind of debate society, or if it's simply working in an extracurricular activity where you're the leader and you have to regularly speak and engage with your volunteers, that can be incredibly helpful to you. There are other things such as the Socratic method, which is a traditional method of teaching in class where a certain number of students are called upon every day and asked various questions, and they have to prepare by reading the cases or other materials. That is something that is harder to experience in undergraduate education experience, and something that you may not be able to do until you get to law school. And I would say for me, going back to the fact that everybody at a great law school is really smart, and just being aware of that fact as you take your tests. The tests are all graded and exams are all graded on a curve. So just be prepared for that there's some incredibly smart people there. So I would say there are certain things you can prepare for being on your feet. And again, I would also mention networking, building a network of potential clients, a potential business contacts is something that you should start from the day you walk on the Georgetown campus. But it's not too late. You can continue to do that. Just, keep in touch with your friends. Find out what they're doing. And if you're someone that they trust for advice personally, academically, they'll likely trust you for their professional advice and assistance, legal services as well.
That's excellent advice, and something that we hear from lots of alumni, that maintaining peer-to-peer networking experiences is so important and critical as you grow through your career. Our next question for you is, Did you consider other career tracks besides practicing law at a large firm before settling into your role?
Yes, I would say before I went to law school, I wanted to be a history professor. So I took the GRE as a senior. My parents, specifically my father, was not encouraging of that career path. He felt that there were not a lot of tenured positions available because the baby boomers had taken up all those spots, and one could argue they still do. So that was something I considered, because my passion outside of the law, one of them, is reading history. And I still enjoy that, and learning about the history of place. My favorite thing to do on a vacation is to buy a local history book and learn about where I am, because that helps me understand where I am, what it's been, what it is now. And then once I went to law school, my first summer, I was at a small firm of 15 attorneys, and I saw the lifestyle that would be, which is a much less onerous lifestyle. And yet, gentlemen and ladies that still made a very good living, still had great client experiences, and for my purposes, got into court a lot. There were corporate lawyers there as well, but I saw that path, and it would have been practicing in my hometown. I chose a different path. I wanted to go to a larger city, which is, you know, sometimes you look back and do you have any regrets about that? Because I mentioned earlier the ability to network and sort of develop contacts where you grew up, or to, you know, not develop them, but go back and nurture them that already exist. So I did consider practicing in my hometown. At the end of the day, I decided I wanted to go to the largest city in the South. The Olympics in 96 had just occurred, and I settled on Atlanta, which at that time was an incredibly hot destination for UVA law students. It's not as much now as it was then. So there were a couple different paths. I think I chose the right one, both for my career and personal life.
And it sounds like you're still able to make use of some of that knowledge from history and the things that you love about history in your daily life instead of doing it through your career, which is important.
I regularly bore people with my knowledge of history, yes.
Our second to last question for you, Curtis, is what can Georgetown students do to make the most of their time before they go into their careers?
That is an incredibly expansive question. So I'll try to just give some thoughts. I mean, I think that I've had conversations with people who are in law school that used to engage in sports activities, that played college sports, things of that nature. And I remember having a conversation with one woman who was a summer associate or a potential summer associate. I can't remember, but she said she used to play volleyball. She played in high school. She played in college. And I told her she was still in her 20s. And I said, you should play club volleyball, because there will come a time when your body will not let you do that. You know, as you get older, that's something that you can really enjoy in your 20s and 30s. It's a great social outlet. It doesn't matter where it's volleyball. It could be any team sport. It could be golf. It could be anything, any sort of activity that gets you out there meeting other people who share passions with you. So I would develop and sort of prepare for the ability to do that. In law school, my biggest regret was that I didn't spend some time third year learning how to play golf, because it is an important part of business marketing. And a lot of my friends do it, and I'm not good at it. And I have never sort of crossed the Rubicon on that. So I would tell folks to sort of, you know, make sure that you continue with your passions and make that a part of your life. The best networking and business marketing is when you're engaged in activities with people who share your passion, because there's easy things to talk about that aren't business that can lead to other opportunities. And make sure you enjoy DC. I mean, you're in one of the major cities of the world. Get off the hilltop. Get around the city, get out on the mall, see the museums, just see everything. You know, check out the Potomac, check out the trail that goes to Cumberland on the Potomac. Maybe you can't go all the way there, but go up to the falls. See the world around you. And of course, go to Georgetown basketball games. You want to do that, no matter how painful it can be. But, you know, take advantage of where you are and look around, smell the roses.
Thank you for sharing that, Curtis. Our final question for you is, what advice do you have for Hoyas who are graduating in 2021, as graduation is right upon us?
Well, because I have been remiss to date in my answers, I would say make sure you're part of Hoya Gateway. Because if you're not a part of Hoya Gateway, then you're missing out. And it's never too late to get involved. The networking and advice you can learn from there can benefit you as a senior, as a young alum, as an older alum, as someone who's transitioning careers. There's so many levels of available resources and potential colleagues and friends and peers in there that can help you. 2, take advantage of the fact that Zoom and similar platforms, FaceTime, Microsoft Teams, WebEx, Google Chat, I think it is. I've had to use all of them with clients. Use them to continue your network, to stay in touch with your friends, to ask for advice from, you know, family, friends, to professors. Use the fact that it's so easy to hop on a video conference with someone. You don't necessarily have to have time to go somewhere to meet them at a coffee shop. It's much easier to virtually meet somebody. So do it. Don't not take advantage of that opportunity to build a network virtually that one day you can, you know, experience in person. But I just think it's way easier to stay in touch with folks now. And it's become such a normal thing that's not going to change. This sort of virtual hanging out, chatting, catching up is going to be something that people do. And these platforms will be used professionally, socially, personally, however you want to use them. So I would take advantage of that. Those are the best pieces of advice I could talk about with Hoyas in 2021. Oh, thirdly, I would say stay in touch with your classmates. Join your local Georgetown club if you have one. If not, look for the contacts in your area that can help facilitate your continuing connection to the Hilltop and the Hilltop community. I mean, Georgetown is a community for life. It's not just a community for when you're on the Hilltop or when you need to get a job or when you need to change jobs. It's a community that can support you across all generations for the rest of your life. And don't forget to take advantage of that. That's one of the reasons we come to Georgetown. That's one of the reasons the price of education at Georgetown is steep. We all know that. The biggest benefit in addition to the educational opportunities is the network. Never forget that.
Advice to last the ages, definitely. Thank you so much, Curtis. And thank you again for your time and insight.
Absolutely. My pleasure.